We'll only talk about just a little while. That's all I know. That's all I know. That was good one. And over here, we have a man in headphones that's trying to hear what's going on and make sure he has a focus and ability to see. And it helps because he has his glasses on. And he's still messing with it. Is it getting any better, any worse?
Oh, I don't have it. Do you need this up here?
All right.
Enter and sign in, please.
I'm live.
He is live. Thank you. We're glad that you came to be with us. We are waiting for the audience here. We got about 10 minutes here. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit. And that way you won't be completely bored while you're sitting there waiting for us. This is on live. People, I'm talking to the... here I am, talking to a camera. This natural man here, talking to a camera.
Are you sure that's fine?
This is just for that.
Yeah, this is live on...
This is live on the internet. This is for the internet.
Yeah.
I told you that already, Al. You're not paying... This is for you guys, not for us guys, okay? Al's trying to confuse me, and it was working. So what we're here about is this thing that's called... We refer to it as sulfide mining. We don't think that that is a healthy thing to be doing to Mother Earth. The reason it's not healthy is because it pollutes the water. There's one thing that, one of the things that's necessary for life is water. So we're going to have a presentation by Professor Al Geddix in about 10 minutes. Meanwhile, you'll just have to look at this open pit sulfide mining. And do you have any watchers yet? Am I talking to myself?
Just keep talking.
You're doing real good. That's easy for you to say because you don't have to bring up any. Hey, no laughing at the talent. The talent has not started doing any jokes yet. She's over here just having a good time. I'm glad. You know, here's where it all begins. People eating in front of you. People bring their lunch in. Do you think they bring an extra hamburger or maybe a French fry or something? No, they just sit there and eat. We tell them, come on in and eat. Just share. But they don't believe in sharing. I'm just kidding. We're just trying to make time fly here. Time does not fly, but it's amazing what time does do. Time heals all. Time is of the essence. But really, time is a healing thing. If you let time go by, my brother here is healing because of time. He'll explain that to you later. Maybe not, but we'll just leave those out there for you guys. Is anybody there? Wave at me. I'm waving at you. I don't know if anybody's there. We're just filling time here until we really start. I've really started, but I started when I reached this stage. I'm an extra. I'm the MC for the evening. My name is insignificant, but it is Tony Brown. We're not here about individual things. We're here about this big canoe we're on. It's referred to that way as a big canoe because there's only one, and we're all on it. And we're trying to get you to realize that we cannot continue polluting Mother Earth. We cannot continue doing these things. Boy, these burgers really look good over here. Look at, oh, juicy burgers too. Man, look at it, just dripping all over. Corporations really don't care about anything. They don't care about us. They only care about their bottom line, and their bottom line is cash. Cash is the cow here. And so we're talking against making money in a sense, but that's not really true. We're not against anything. We're just trying to protect the water. Wisconsin Natural Resources Council, the Menominee Tribe, the River Alliance, Conservation Voters. That's a mouthful there. League of Wisconsin Conservation Voters. All of these have banded together, and most of this has to do with grassroots organizing, and that's where I come in. I'm a grassroots organizer on the Menominee Reservation in order to fight this pollution of Mother Earth, to fight this sometimes there's not a good word to express about this, what's being done to Mother Earth, because It's not something that we're used to going on. It's not something that our languages really refer to, because it's not even thought of in our cultures. And Mark Denny will talk about that after Algetics. So I think we're about ready to begin. The Molly here, everybody ready? Once we start, we'll have no smacking of lips, please. Okay, Molly.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming. I'm Molly.
I'm Kelly.
Kelly, we're here.
Come on, Kelly. Come on up here, Kelly. There you go. This is for the people on the...
Is this on?
For the internet.
Okay. Hello. All right. We're here from Carroll University's Eco Club, and we've been working with Keisha Patel and the Wisconsin Youth Network to form this speaking tour all throughout colleges around Wisconsin. So I'd like to welcome Keisha up here to introduce our speakers tonight.
Well, more importantly, I'm going to do the introduction of the speakers, but she's going to tell a little bit more about Gaia. Did I say that? A little bit?
A little bit, yeah.
There you go.
Okay.
Talk to the mic. Talk to the guy right there.
Okay.
He's smiling at you.
Okay. So, my name is Keisha, and I have been organizing the speaking tour along with Lee Stedman, who works with me at the Gaia Coalition Network, and Leela Allen, who also works with me. Leela, you want to come up here? Okay. And so we've been organizing the speaking tour. It's about 18 universities have signed on, and a few other community venues and community organizations such as 350 and Peace Action. And we've been doing this tour since like early October. And so these speakers have been going all across Wisconsin and talking at different universities, at different venues, educating people about the effects of the Back 40 mine, the dangers of sulfide mining, and how the Menominee Nation is affected by these dangers, and how their culture is affected by this mine, by all of these mines. So I think that we're really lucky to have all these speakers here at Carroll today. And so we're going to have Dr. Al Geddix, who's going to talk about the dangers of sulfide mining. We have Mark Denning, and we have Tony here. Okay.
Thank you, Tony.
Yes.
So, don't look at the screen for a second. I want to show of hands. How many people have heard the term sulfide mining before tonight? Half the audience, this is a very educated audience. 99% of the American public have never heard the term sulfide mining. This is no accident. Because the industry has a vested interest in not talking about sulfide mining. They refer to gold mining, copper mining, zinc mining, nickel mining, all these base metals, because that is what makes a profit for the companies. What is left behind, which is 99% of the rock that comes out of the ground, contains sulfide minerals, mainly pyrite, and when you blast and crush and pulverize the rocks that contain the tiny trace amounts of gold, silver, copper, what you're left with are sulfide minerals in the waste material. And so, for instance, in a ton of rock, you get maybe at most 3 pounds of copper or 3 pounds of gold. 1,997 pounds ends up as sulfide mine waste. When those sulfides are exposed to air and water, there's a chemical reaction that takes place that turns the combination into sulfuric acid. The sulfuric acid then leaches out other heavy metals, 26 different heavy metals, including lead, arsenic, mercury, all of which are toxic to aquatic organisms and human beings at parts per billion and parts per million levels. This is not what the company uses to promote mining in communities where they want to extract minerals, because if they told the truth, the dirty secret about sulfide mining, there would be no community in their right mind that would agree to have its communities subjected to a massive assault on the environment that leaves these communities with the vast majority of the waste material containing these heavy metals and sulfides that will pollute in perpetuity. Biologists and chemists know precisely well that when this chemical reaction begins and you expose the sulfides to air and water, you create a chemical reaction which is a perpetual pollution machine. It doesn't stop, right? So there are mines that go back to the Roman Empire 1,500 years ago that are still generating acid mine drainage. This is the equivalent of radioactive waste, right? This is obviously not a very good selling point to convince communities that they ought to rent out their land and their resources and their water to an industry which has a horrendous track record of polluting groundwater and surface water in perpetuity. So my title of my talk is not Gold and Silver Mining at the Back 40 Project, which is the company's name for this open pit sulfide mine on the Menominee River, bordering Michigan and Wisconsin, because that would be a misleading title. Has nothing to do with what is the experience of the community now and in the future dealing with the consequences of massive amounts of mine waste containing sulfide mineralization. So the important impression one should get from this slide is that this is the site of the proposed Back 40 mine. And by the way, even the term Back 40 is a misnomer. The site is nowhere near 40 acres. The open pit by itself is 83 acres. The entire mine site, including the processing plants and the waste disposal area and the wastewater treatment plant, encompasses 600 acres, not 40 acres, right? So the whole presentation of this project in the mass media and by the industry and by the state of Michigan, by the way, is designed to create an atmosphere of acceptance and passivity on the part of people that ought to be up in arms about what is being proposed for this area and for this landscape. So the area where the company, the Canadian company named Aquila Resources, wants to construct an open pit sulfide mine is right here on the banks of the Menominee River, 150 feet from the river. 150 feet from one of the largest river system in the Upper Peninsula, has a drainage area or a discharge area of 4,000 square miles. Any contamination from the site, from the open pit, from the waste material, from all the processing operations, the transport of cyanide, which is used to separate the gold from the rest of the waste rock, all that material, 150 feet from the river. Not a good place to put toxic chemicals in such a fragile environment. This is an artist's conception of what the open pit would look like if it were to be permitted and constructed. And of course, the whole point of this tour is to alert people about the dangers of sulfide mining so that this scenario never happens. And of course, the other point about this tour, named Stop Sulfide Mine Tour, is up until yesterday, was to promote awareness of the attempts of the legislature to repeal what Tony talked about earlier as the mining moratorium law, also known as Prove It First law, which requires, before the state of Wisconsin can grant permission for a sulfide mine, the applicant has to show where they mine in a sulfide ore body in the United States or Canada that has not polluted the environment. Since the law was passed in 1998, not a single company has come up with a single example in the United States or Canada where they have mined in a sulfide ore body without contaminating groundwater or surface water. So the companies are not banned from doing sulfide mining in Wisconsin. They simply have to meet a condition. They have to show, prove it first, where they've done it without contaminating the environment. They haven't been able to do that, and so now they want to abolish the law because they cannot possibly meet the conditions of the law. And last night, we had a horrendous display of disloyalty and untrustworthiness on the part of legislators who legislated in favor of an out-of-state mining company instead of the interest of the vast majority of the people in Wisconsin who value clean water and who depend upon clean water for their survival, for their economy, and for their culture. So last night, by a vote of 19-14, the Senate passed a repeal of Wisconsin's historic mining moratorium law, also known as Prove It First. So that part of the tour is irrelevant because the damage now has been done on that particular issue. We still have this issue to deal with, which is an ongoing permitting process on the Michigan-Wisconsin border for another sulfide mine. This is the artist's conception of the open pit, and you see it's very close to the Mountain River. This is, or would be, the largest open pit sulfide mine in the upper Midwest. It's 2,000 feet wide, 2,500 feet long, 800 feet deep, which means that it is deeper than the tallest building in the state of Wisconsin, which is the First Federal Building here in Milwaukee. You can fit 2.5 Statue of Liberties in this pit, 800 feet deep, which also means that the vast amount of material coming out of this mine that ends up as toxic waste will be stored permanently on site right next to the largest river system in the Upper Peninsula that drains eventually into Green Bay and Lake Michigan. This is a company that wants to put a mine not only next to a river, but in a floodplain. Another bad idea. You put a mine that has the capacity to discharge toxic material into the local water supply, you put it in a floodplain, which is designed as a warning that there are going to be floods in the area, and you create an inevitable scenario of material, toxic material from the mine, being discharged into the Menominee River. The other important point about this is that the state of Michigan, which is the sole permitting authority over this mine project, despite the fact that it is an interstate water body, in which people on the Wisconsin side are going to experience the negative impacts. The state of Michigan is the sole permitting authority in this matter. The DEQ has not disclosed that the company intends not just to have an open pit mine, but after 8 years of open pit mining, they would have another 8 years of underground mining. And that underground mining would go under the Menominee River. So not only is it another set of risks, but the whole point of the environmental review process is that the public needs to understand what are the risks involved in the project. And if they're not told that this is a 16-year project, which involves not 50 million tons of waste, but 100 million tons of waste, this is a direct assault on the democratic right of people to be informed about decisions that their government is making on their behalf and supposedly in their interests. So the DEQ knows precisely well that the application that is in front of them, which says that this is an 8-year open pit mine, is a fraudulent application, because Aquila Mining Company has told their shareholders in press releases that the DEQ is perfectly aware of, that this is a combined open pit and underground mine, but the second half of the project is not being disclosed, is not being evaluated, and is being misrepresented for people that are not following this on a day-by-day basis, which is the vast majority of Michigan and Wisconsin public. So to give you a sense of where this mine is located, it is the headwaters of the Menominee River on the Michigan-Wisconsin border. The Menominee River flows down into Green Bay, eventually empties into Lake Michigan, so that any contamination that is discharged into the Menominee River is eventually going to end up in Lake Michigan, which is part of the Great Lakes, which is 20% of the world's fresh water, and is a resource that 44 million people in the Lake Michigan area depend on for their drinking water, for their commerce, for their cultural and recreational opportunities. And to risk that kind of destruction in such a precious natural resource, irreplaceable natural resource, is the height of insanity. The federal government, the state governments of Michigan and Wisconsin have all invested millions of dollars, upwards of $41 million, to clean up the Menominee River from past dumping practices of paper mills. They've now cleaned up the river to where it is now a viable habitat, the sturgeon, and other fish populations, as well as clean drinking water for people downstream from the Menominee, headwaters of the Menominee River. And now, the state of Michigan is on the verge of issuing permits to allow more pollution after they've just spent $41 million trying to clean up previous era of pollution. This is also the site of Menominee Nation's original villages. Before the Menominee Nation was relocated, forcibly relocated from Michigan to Wisconsin in suppressed preservation, the site of the nomination was at the actual mine site. Dr. David Overstreet, archaeologist, has described this area as an extensive cultural landscape. It's not just a few burial mounds here and some raised garden beds and village sites. It is an entire miles-long landscape along the Menominee River that is at risk of being destroyed by a mining company that wants a short-term profit for a very small amount of gold and zinc. So the chairman of the Menominee tribe has said, our place of origin at the mouth of the Menominee River may be destroyed by any adverse impacts on the land, environment, and water from mining disasters. And Mark will talk much more about what this destruction means for the Menominee Nation. So here's the basic chemistry of sulfide mining. This is not a secret. This is well known to anyone that understands basic chemistry. You take a sulfide ore body, and before that ore body is extracted, you have a fresh or a healthy ecosystem supporting fish populations and other aquatic life. You expose this aquatic environment to sulfide mineralization under the pressure of air and water, creating sulfuric acid and releasing heavy metals into the environment, creating a toxic environment for any aquatic or any kind of living organism. The best estimate we have on the basis of existing sulfide mining operations is that this industry will pollute 27 billion gallons of water, fresh water, per year. And that is all because of this well-known chemical process of acid mine drainage. This is what acid mine drainage looks like. It's a discoloration of the streams and the rivers that are the recipient of waste material from the mining process. And of course, some of the most important heavy metals that are released that are extremely toxic to both aquatic organisms and human beings are arsenic, lead, and mercury, all of which cause innumerable health problems that I'm not going to go into, but if you're interested, all you have to do is Google acid mine drainage and heavy metal contamination, and you will get a long list of health effects, adverse health effects from exposure to these metals. Now, I said at the very beginning, you take a ton of rock, you get 3 pounds of copper or zinc, 1,997 pounds end up as waste material. That waste material is called tailings. The tailings are what comes out of the milling process, where they pulverize, crush the rock, put all sorts of harsh chemicals in the processing, including cyanide and sulfuric acid. And at the end of that process, you end up with a fine standing material having the consistency of talcum powder. You have talcum powder piled hundreds of feet high, a mile wide, in these structures conveniently and mislabeled as tailings containment areas. The last thing these facilities do is contain the tailings. Now, you have in this diagram, which is taken from a mining publication, you have what the industry called dike walls, supposedly holding up the entire tailings disposal facility and the fine sandy talcum-like material. But the material that is holding up the other waste material is simply more fine sandy material. It's not any kind of permanent structure. Notice also that there is a provision for leakage in the tailings area because they have seepage collection ditches where they collect all the seepage that comes out of the tailings area. So when you have rainfall that flows through the tailings area, it's like pouring water through coffee grounds, except at the bottom you don't get coffee, you get toxic liquid. That toxic liquid is collected and recirculated in a waste treatment plant so that it can be discharged to surface waters. Now that is the ideal scenario during the life of the mine. What happens after the mine closes, after 10, 20 years? There's no wastewater treatment plant anymore. The company may have gone bankrupt. Who is going to collect the wastewater, and who is going to make sure that that wastewater does not enter the groundwater and the surface water? No one. Or if there is anyone, it's going to be at taxpayer expense. This is the unaccountable part of the mining process, which is what is the responsibility of the company versus what is the responsibility of the public for handling this waste material, which is going to be there in perpetuity. And of course, the problem with these waste containment areas is that they rarely contain all the wastes. So in the modern era, we have modern mining technology like the one that ended up in January 2000 with a spill of 100 tons of cyanide contaminated water that was released into the Tiso River in Hungary, destroying 1,400 tons of fish, the livelihoods of the entire fishing industry along the Tiso River, and the shutdown of drinking water supplies that depended upon the Tiso River as a source of their drinking water along Romanian and Hungarian towns. Now, these kind of accidents, whether with cyanide materials or other toxic chemicals, are such a frequent occurrence in the mining industry that voters in Montana banned the use of cyanide in mining in 1998, the Czech Republic banned it in 2000, and the Menominee County Board, which is where Aquila has its home base of operations right next to the proposed mine site, even the Menominee County Board has passed a resolution opposing the use of cyanide in Menominee County. Now, the industry will tell you that these kind of accidents are rare occurrences, that they've learned from the past mistakes, and that the new generation of mining control technology is much better than it was in the past, and the public should be reassured that these events are unlikely to happen. All of that is complete and total nonsense. The best material we have on what the actual record of the industry is comes from a study and shows that waste failures are increasing in frequency, severity, and cost all around the world. It's not hard to understand why these accidents are increasing in size, cost, and frequency, because all it involves is an understanding of elemental geology, which is that the richest veins of copper and zinc and gold have already been mined out. Right? What is left in the Earth's crust are trace quantities of these metals. And in order to make a profit off of extracting these trace quantities of metals, you have to expand your scope of operations to include vast open pits that discharge and dislodge large amounts of rock that contain tiny amounts of metals. And when you do that, what you end up with is a large amount of waste. The larger the open pit, the larger the waste material that has to be contained. So you take a 1 ounce quantity of gold in your average gold wedding ring or your gold graduation ring, that 1 ounce of gold resulted in 20 tons of toxic waste. 1 ounce of gold, 20 tons of toxic waste, that is the ratio that is the standard in the industry, meaning that those tons of waste have to be contained in perpetuity in structures that were never designed during a period of awareness of climate change and what climate change bodes in terms of increasing frequency and severity of storms, precipitation, tornadoes, hurricanes, like we've seen in the last month all over the world. Those kind of events were not part of the engineering that went into the design of these tailings ponds. These tailings ponds are pre-climate change, and so all of these events that we now take for granted that are going to impinge on the stability of these tailings areas were never designed to withstand those kind of events. So we have nearly half of all recorded serious failures happened in modern times between 1990 and 2010. This is not something from the 19th century or even the 20th century. This is something that's happening now and that will happen with increasing frequency and severity and cost in the future. Now, to give you some sense of why this is severe, I mean, look at the height of some of these tailings areas. 500 feet, which is the height of the Washington Monument. 700 feet, the height of the Hoover Dam. 748 feet, the height of the New York Times building. Right, these are vast, unstable structures waiting to be affected by forces of nature that human beings have no control over. And so it's not accidental that in the most experienced mining country in the world, in Canada, where there's more mining than any other place on Earth, in 2014, you had 1 billion gallons of mining waste spilling into rivers from a tailings dam at the Mount Holly Gold Mine at the headwaters of the Fraser River in British Columbia. The downstream communities were mostly indigenous communities who depended upon the river for their drinking water and for their subsistence. Aquila, which is the company proposing this open pit sulfide mine on the Michigan-Wisconsin border, only minimally addresses the potential impacts of accidents or spills, dismissing potential impacts as minimal. I wouldn't call 1 billion gallons of mine waste suddenly being discharged into a major river as a minimal event. Aquila thinks that this is a minimal event, and therefore they do not have to discuss it, and they do not have to disclose what the chances are of that happening at the proposed Back 40 mine site. Again, a misrepresentation of what is being planned for downstream communities on the Michigan-Wisconsin border. Now notice, here is the fine sanding material I talked about earlier, having the consistency of talcum powder. This is where the breach occurred. This breach, in fact, was not the result of a severe weather event. This was a breach that was a direct result of the cost-cutting measures of the mining company. The mining company was producing large amounts of waste that needed to be contained in a larger area, and instead of applying for a permit to expand the scope of their waste disposal area, which will require time, effort, and money, they simply bypassed the entire permit process, and they simply expanded their waste material, not horizontally, but vertically. They simply piled hundreds of millions of more tons of tailings on the already unstable structure that was already in place, and you add 100% more waste material onto an already fragile structure underlying the entire tailings area, and you crack the bedrock underneath. There's only so much weight that can be applied to even rock material under the tailings area before it cracks, and once that cracks, you create a breach, and that is what happened at the Mount Holly mine in August of 2014. This is the same Fraser River a month after the spill, and you can see already that the precipitation of the toxic materials in the waste material has already infiltrated the entire environment. It's incorporated into the sediments, into the soils, and into the shoreline along the river, and it will be there for how long? We don't know, because there's never been a successful cleanup of this kind of spill. This, by the way, this mine was promoted by the mining industry as an example of how sulfide mining can coexist with clean water. Well, that wasn't a very good demonstration. It didn't happen. Scientists say it is virtually impossible to clean up the mess left behind the spill. That is why the Menominee River has been declared by the American Rivers Group as one of the 10 most endangered rivers in America from the threat of open pit sulfide mining. Aquila provides almost no information on the impacts of a spill, how long this impact could last, and whether the impacts could be reversed, another violation of the transparency requirements of the environmental review process. Now, the industry particularly Aquila Mining has argued that the reason we don't need a mining moratorium in Wisconsin is because we already have an example at the Flambeau mine in Ladysmith in Rust County of a successful sulfide mining operation that did not pollute the environment. And again, this is total absolute nonsense. Here's the headline from the Milwaukee Journal. 14 years after the closing of the mine, water samples on the site show high levels of toxic pollutants. And here is the open pit at the Flambeau mine in Ladysmith, 150 feet again from the Flambeau River, very parallel to the proposed open pit mine at Back 40, and you have the headline of toxic metals at the river. The discharge of toxic metals from this mine was the subject of a clean water suit in 2012, in which the federal judge, Robert Crabb, ruled the Flambeau Mining Company had violated the Clean Water Act on numerous counts by discharging toxic materials into the Flambeau River on a repeated basis over the years. So if you go to the Flambeau mine today, you will see the big sign about how great the reclamation effort is. You will not see a sign indicating that it has violated the Clean Water Act, because you will not see the pollution underground that is being discharged from the mine into the Flamingo River. And so Russell Churchill has a sign here, this is grass over a grave. The company that was convicted of violation of the Clean Water Act appealed that decision to the appellate court. The appellate court overturned the district court, not because there was no pollution, they overturned the decision because the company argued that because they had a permit to pollute from the Wisconsin Department of Natural Resources, they could not be held accountable for a violation of the Clean Water Act. And the court agreed with this nonsense and absolved the company of any liability. Again, not addressing the fundamental issue of whether there was ongoing pollution at the site. And so in 2014, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency listed the Flambeau River at the tributary at the mine site as impaired water. This is a scientific term indicating a certain amount of toxicity in the water, particularly zinc and copper, linked to the Flambeau mine. And as of the fall of 2016, copper levels in this tributary, here's the tributary, stream C flowing directly into the Flambeau River, still exceed the acute toxicity level despite all the attempts of the company to mitigate the environmental pollution. So not only has the company already polluted, but they're still polluting 14 years after the closure of this mine. So they weren't able to do a clean mine at Flambeau. Flambeau is one quarter the size of the proposed Back 40 mine. Flambeau had no processing on site. In other words, they had no tailings to deal with because the ore was so rich at Flambeau, they shipped the entire unprocessed ore to Canada, where the milling process took place, and Canada had to deal with the tailings. So if there were ever to be an example of a successful sulfide mine, Flambeau would have been the example because they didn't have to worry about all the toxic tailings. They did have to worry about high sulfide mine waste that was still at the site. And even then, they couldn't prevent those sulfide mine waste from contaminating local water and eventually the Flambeau River. So here is a situation where they couldn't do it in a smaller mine where they didn't have the problem with tailings. There's never going to be an example of a sulfide mine anywhere in the upper Midwest or in the United States that is as small as the Flambeau mine or that has the ideal conditions for handling mine waste as Flambeau. Flambeau didn't succeed, and there's no reason to expect that any other sulfide mine will succeed either. And so it should not be a surprise that there's substantial opposition to the Back 40 mine among the residents in Menominee and Merrimack County, and in fact all the way down on the Wisconsin side of the river, all the way to Green Bay and Lake Michigan. The status of the mine today is that the state of Michigan has granted 3 of the 4 permits they need for the project. There's a 4th permit that is pending. It's the wetlands permit, and it is the most difficult permit in terms of assessing what the consequences of the mine would be. And in fact, there is a federal lawsuit, or a notice of a federal lawsuit. It was filed by the Menominee Tribe just yesterday, saying that the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers have not adequately taken responsibility for an interstate water body and allowed the state of Michigan to assume exclusive permitting authority over a federal water body, thus ignoring the interests of the Wisconsin residents as well as the interests of the Menominee Tribe. If the EPA and the Army Corps do not respond to the notice of intent to sue, there will be a federal lawsuit challenging the Army Corps of Engineers and the EPA with violation of the Clean Water Act, which will require them to respond why they are not taking the responsibility seriously. In the meantime, the state of Michigan refuses to allow the Menominee Tribe to have consultation status about what the impact of this mine would be on their sacred sites at the mine site. And they have also, both Michigan and the company has failed to engage in any kind of meaningful dialogue or consultation with the Menominee Tribe. The Merrimack County Board, which is right across the river on the Wisconsin side of the border, voted 28-0 to oppose the mine. 28 people on the county board, unanimous opposition to the mine. This is not a Democratic or Republican issue. This is a water issue that affects everyone, regardless of their political affiliation. And that is why not only Baronet, but Brown, Door, O'Connell, Menominee, Shawano counties in Wisconsin, plus half a dozen towns in Michigan, even the Menominee County Board in Michigan, where the headquarters of the company is located, have passed resolutions against this mine, because people understand that this is a threat to their survival, to their economic and their cultural survival. In other words, the project has no social license to operate. What do we mean by a social license? What we mean by a social license is that the mining company does not have the support of the local community. And unless it does have the support of the local community, they are at risk of protests, blockades, media campaigns, or legal challenges such as the legal challenge I just mentioned from the Menominee tribe. Now, this is not a term that is coined by the environmental community. This is a term that was coined by the mining industry itself on the basis of repeated experiences in Latin America where they have been granted permission to mine, but the local community has voted against the mine in plebiscites and referendums where 90% of the population comes out and votes against the project. When that happens, investors pull their money out of the project because this is a financially risky investment, and that is why the companies understand that they need to have a social license to operate. Now, the other dynamic behind this whole process of promoting the Back 40 mine and also overturning the mining moratorium law is that the same company that wants to mine at the Back 40 project in Michigan, Wisconsin, is behind the attempt, or behind the successful attempt, to overturn the mining moratorium law. Senator Tom Tiffany, the legislative author of the Mining Repeal Act, consulted Aquila Resources about the language of the bill, including the repeal of the mining moratorium. This is the same company that has interests in the Bend project in Taylor County, in the Shawangan National Forest, and in the Reef project just outside of Wausau in Marathon County. These are sulfide mine deposits that Aquila Resources wants to extract and which they have been prevented from developing because they cannot meet the requirements of proving it first, showing where they mine in the sulfide ore body without contaminating the environment. So overturning the mining moratorium law means that now people in central and northern Wisconsin are going to be subjected to further assaults in addition to the Back 40 as these projects continue in the absence of the protection of the Proven First Law. So, one of the areas that would be affected by the repeal of the mining moratorium law is the Reef project outside of Wausau, and the discharge of that project would go directly into Marathon County's Eau Claire Hills, one of the prime tourist attractions of north central Wisconsin, eventually discharging into the Wisconsin River. In August 2015, an abandoned gold mine in Colorado on the Durango River accidentally spilled more than 3 million gallons of toxic waste, threatening communities in Colorado, New Mexico, Utah, and the Navajo Nation that drew water from the river. In other words, the pollution extended for hundreds of miles all the way to the New Mexico border and the Navajo Reservation downstream. This is what the Adamas River looked like before the spill. This is what it looked like after the spill. The EPA estimates that 40% of the headwaters of western watersheds are contaminated by acid mine drainage from abandoned and run complaining mines. This is the picture of northern Wisconsin in the aftermath of acid mine drainage repeal, or the pollution from acid mine drainage with the repeal of the mining moratorium law. Mining moratorium law was never a ban on sulfide mining. It was simply a condition that had to be met. The companies and industry couldn't meet the condition, and so they abolished the law. This picture ought to be in the offices of every Republican legislator that voted to repeal the mining moratorium, because this is the legacy they are sharing with future generations in Wisconsin, a legacy of extreme environmental pollution. And they ought to be ashamed of that. Copper sulfide mines are the largest source of taxpayer liability under the EPA's Superfund cleanup program, which involves requiring mining companies to provide funds for cleaning up mine operations 40 years to in perpetuity. These sites have the potential to cost between $7 and $24 billion to clean up. And here is Senator Tiffany, the prime author of the Running Moratorium Appeal. The other aspect of the Running Moratorium Appeal law, misleadingly titled Money for America Act, when you have a bad piece of legislation, you simply wrap it in the American flag and people will buy it and not look at the fine print of what's actually happening. The same bill that repeals the money moratorium law removes a revocable trust fund that requires companies to put a certain amount of money in a trust fund so that if there are accidents or cleanups after the mining company closes its operation, the taxpayers will not be on the hook for that cleanup. That trust fund, the revocable trust fund, has been withdrawn because it's an inconvenience to the industry. So that's my presentation, and I'll turn it over to Tony.
Well, what we're going to do now is change gears a little bit. We really appreciate you coming, but one of the aspects of this mine is that it's being proposed on the site of our ancestors. It's a site of our origin, and it's a site that we've just received the bones and repatriated the bones and reburied them this past weekend. It was very moving. I'll talk maybe a little bit more about that later, but this time we're going to turn it over to Mark, and Mark's going to talk to you a little bit more about the cultural aspect of this mine, what it's going to do to some of the culture. Thank you. And here is Mark Denny.
Bueno, pues yo le voy a Duke, not a way but nazi indigenous cons, ni me ingo de. Ni o tiaga, un nomi, un shinami, mohikina. But not being Delaware and down, ni opit, in don juban. There was a time when the language like that and other languages were the only languages that were spoken here. And with those languages comes a way of thinking. And that way of thinking was one of the only ways of thinking. And now there's new thinking. And I think their education in the United States needs to take responsibility for it. And that responsibility is this. You're a generation amongst the first to be taught in schools where we're teaching you to the test. Generations before you, we were taught about critical thinking. In other words, given information, what do you do with that information, and how do you deal with that information, and where do you move forward once you've come through all of those checkpoints when you're gaining information? We're not doing that anymore in schools. What we're doing is we're asking our teachers to just say, we want a performance-based test. Depending on how the students perform, then we're going to base your performance as teachers. So of course, teachers are now teaching to the test. And what I mean by that is this. The sorts of lessons that could be learned from this are not being learned because there's no room for other sorts of thinking. When you look at the state of Wisconsin and you think about Native people, and I do every day because I'm one of them, I would ask you to remember this, that we are just a few percentage points of the entire population of Wisconsin. For us to have any force of voice and votes in any part of an electoral process in the state is asking almost for the impossible. We're not in this alone. And this information that we're giving to you is things that I hope that you would use. Just a few moments ago, I stepped out of this room and I went down to the basement. Four times as many people down there as there are here. But yet we're talking about an issue that faces each and every one of them. And for those of you in the geological sciences, those of you in environmental sciences, those of you who are in social services, you have a great job that's in front of you. Because you may be charged with the protecting people that don't even know what kind of work that you're doing, but what kind of thoughts are brought to it. An example, when Professor Geddes is up here and talks about mining and all the things that are happening
in our great state of Wisconsin. In my home, it's been my ancestors' home for over 10,000 years. When he talks about it, the very first thing that occurs to me is, what kind of thinking makes this possible? Because it's not even possible within my social construct. The question that you're facing today is the very question that faced my ancestors when our vast communities came together. At the time of contact, there were about 112 million Native American people in the Americas. 112 million. And by the year 1900, there were 350,000 left in North America. Imagine what that must have looked like. And losing all of those people, a lot of our thought is lost. But there are pockets where our thought is retained. And some of those pockets are within our religions, religions that you've never heard of, but they've been here for years. When it comes to a conflict of thinking and culture, I'm looking at the floor that I'm standing on, and it's a parquet floor. The question that you're facing today is the same question again as my ancestors faced all those years ago when we contacted each other. And looking at this floor, I see a floor. Other people are drawn to the different squares and the different components of the floor, depending on where you come from. It was that same way when it came to the land for my ancestors. When we look at the land, we saw territories. We saw areas and vast expanses of land that could be used by us and other tribal people. We lived in partnership with each other. When historical writers write about us in his story, written by other people, they often define our cultures and our boundaries in terms of war. Certainly that's not how we did it. We shared spaces together. And so while we had territories, we didn't do a European model of this space belongs to you, this place belongs to me, this place over here belongs to the other person, and now within the political context of today, this square over here belongs to a corporation because that's a person too. When we were faced with that kind of thinking, it was beyond our comprehension that private property was even a thought. So what is it with you today? Take your friends, take your brother, take your mother, take your son or daughter, take them to Lake Michigan, right here in Milwaukee. Take them to Milwaukee, the river, and then look out at the water when you're standing with your friend or the person you love, and have a thought. And that thought is, who owns this place? Who owns it? As you look out over Lake Michigan, that is what's happening. That is what binds the issue of the Back 40 mining issue in Michigan, which is just you can throw a football across the river. And all over the country today, your culture is faced with the very same question my culture faced. Our question was about the land. Your question and my question today is about the water. Who owns the water? The commodification of water is. There are corporations working day and night to privatize water. If you doubt it, put it in your search terms in Google, you'll find it. Nestle's is one of those companies. They say water has to be privatized. If we privatize it, we're better able to protect it. Just like they say we can provide water to the people of Flint, Michigan, for a charge. The first deliveries were free. You'll see other mines that have happened here in Wisconsin, where people used to be able to drink water for centuries. And just within the last few years, they need pipelines 12 miles long to get water for their communities. And that's not going to change. The only people that stand between that circumstance in your community is you. If you think Milwaukee is not a part of this water issue, ask your grandparents about it. Not long ago, when I stationed in Hawaii, there was an outbreak of a disease here in Milwaukee, and many thousands of people. just continue to drink water. You will be fine. And at the end of the day, what was the sickness? It was cryptosporidium. It was being spread out of a water provision plant right here in Milwaukee, and people died. So when we think about water, the issue is as close as when you walk outside this door and when you have a child. Each and every one of you that had a natural childbirth, your announcement into this world was through the announcement of water rushing before your birth, breaking the water. How amazing that is to think about that sacred moment. And nobody thinks about it that way. The water is the blood of the earth. The land is the flesh of the earth. And when people talk about these kinds of issues, like no dapple that happened just a little while ago, think of it this way. When Dr. Geddes talks about after so many years, the mind stops, and then they begin to burrow under the Maumee River itself. Well, it'd be like someone coming to me, loading a syringe full of heroin, taking that needle, cleaning it off, extending my mother's arm, taking that needle, running it under her vein, pushing it through, and then saying, don't worry about it, it'll be fine, I'll take care of it. We have nothing to say about it. And that's how personal this is. The United Nations itself defines American Indian people, Native people, Indigenous people, those who are bound to the land as sure as they are standing here and surviving. Whenever there's an issue, our Grand Chief of Manawin, and that is the Three Fires Confederacy, that I am a member of, that lodge way within the Manazi, when he talks about these kinds of things, he always says, start with the origin. Begin at the beginning whenever you are looking at an issue and start your conversation there. Culturally, you need to do that. Culturally, I'm at a university and Christianity at this university is very important. It could be why you chose to be at this university because Christian faith is so vitally important to you. And within that dominant culture here in the United States of Christian faith, you can look at the book of Genesis and who was the first one who was created. It was a man. And that man walked through the world naming things. And women were created out of him. And when we look at that origin story, it can tell you a lot of what's happening now. It can tell you a lot about what conversations are happening and not happening. It can tell you a lot about how we approach the world. Are we living in a culture, and that culture is this? If we create a problem, we can find an answer because that's how smart we are. If we create a problem, that's okay because this is our world. This is our world. This is my world as an individual. For a Native person with a Native faith, and I cannot speak for all American Indians, there are over 500 tribes alone here in our United States. There's over 40,000 American Indians in the state of Wisconsin. I can only represent myself and my own opinion and my own faith, my own experiences. That's what I'm doing up here. When I think about the creation story, the place that Dr. Geddes is talking about is the very creation of human life itself. I can't imagine in Christian beliefs that the sacred site such as Jerusalem, if it had this kind of issue, that someone could go there and say, we're going to open pit mine that area. We're going to open pit the mine within Menominee creation story. Remember, Menominee is a reservation. This is the Menominee River, Menominee area, where a lot of our ancestors lived. Grew corn, grew children, dance rings exist there. And not far from there, the first human being emerged from the earth. That first emergence of a being was a bear. And that bear was transferred by creation. to become human. We even have a dance for it. That dance was brought back by historic preservationists in our tribe. And that dance was taught to young children like myself, and it's a bear dance. Where we begin to dance as bears, and as we dance along, we become human. What I'm talking about is that creation story and that creative place is so vitally important to us. But because we're not many in number, because people don't take our culture seriously, it's okay to do the kinds of things that we're talking about today. But if it was being done to your culture, you would pay attention to it. You would think about it. If your creation story wedded you to the earth, you would look at these things quite differently. And I'm not trying to convert you to Native American religions or Native American thought. I'm trying to engage you in the thought that we're talking about today. Dr. Geddes isn't talking about getting rid of all minds. Tony isn't talking about getting rid of all minds. He's saying do it safely. Operate a mind safely. The after effects, have them be safe. That's all we're looking for, and that's all Wisconsin wanted to have up until yesterday. So my cultural piece, as I kind of sum up the very few points that I have, is in a singular moment in our Madewin Lodge that happened in 2003. That singular moment in our Madewin Lodge, and I try to say something different each time I come here, is that there were hundreds of Native people gathered from the United States and Canada within our lodge that we worship. We'll come together 3 times a year, 4 times a year, sometimes more, several days, several nights. And by way of Ndinezi, one of the founders of the American Indian movement, who saw American Indian freedom in a spirituality, not in taking over buildings, but in freeing ourselves with our own faith and with our own thoughts, founder of that American Indian movement, who was brought in to give it a spiritual base. He asked those Madewins and non-Madewin people who were gathered within our lodge. He said, one day water would be worth more than an ounce of gold. And that water would become to such a place that a lot of humanity will not be. And he challenged those who were assembled in our Madewin Lodge and said, what are you going to do about it? What will you do about it? And only one person came forward. And this is the point. A person can make a difference as you sit there. One of the co-signers to the bill on this mining issue was from right here in Waukesha. Call his office. Ask. In all the public hearings in Wisconsin when we talked about mining, sulfide mining, what were the numbers of people that testified for the mining and those against? Unimportant. Unimportant. What was important to our elected official was conversations with friends he knew, business associates, and the silent majority of Americans that don't show up. This is what I'm saying, and this is a moment we inherit. I'm going back to that story where our grand chief asked all of us of different tribes of Canada and America, who will stand for the water? One woman came forward, and she was my grandma. And I ended up choked up about this. And she said, I will. I will. And she began a movement of water walks that are happened all across the country. All across the country. She was in her 60s when she did. Josephine Mendelman is her name. Look her up. Imagine what she started with sacred bundles of water, which is us in our life, in our skin, walking around sacred areas of water on this earth. One of the first places she started was the Mississippi River, 60-some years old, to bring attention to the challenges of our water and commodification. this issue is important to you or not. Because the issue that we faced as Native people, when we looked upon this great expanse of the world and thought, this is my mother, the flesh of the earth, the blood of the earth, the rocks are the bones of the earth, this is my mom, this is our earth mother, this is the one that has kept us and loved us. We couldn't imagine owning her. But now we imagine owning the water, and that is a question for your generation. I wish I could tell you what your answer was going to be. I wish I had that kind of crystal ball, but I don't. I can only tell you there's a different way of thinking in this world. And I hope you think about it, critically think about it. Because indigenous thinking that informed the making of the Constitution of the United States is the same thinking that the people that we call our founding fathers integrated into their thinking and created one of the most important documents in the world today, and that's the United States Constitution. They looked at tribal thinking, incorporated it, made something pretty good. It's not too late. Water's on the table right now. And it's up to us.
You know, as we make these trips across the state here to talk to different people, to come and present this to you, what we really, myself, you know, like Mark was saying, we can only speak for ourselves. I'm Menominee, he's also Menominee, but we only speak for ourselves. We don't speak for the tribe. The tribe is doing, as an entity, what it's going to do. But as individuals, what I do as an organizer, and why I've come here to talk to you as an organizer, is to plead with you to please think a little differently. I don't want you to be anti-American. I don't want you to be anti-mining. I want you to be pro-life, and more importantly, I'm sorry I misspoke there, pro-water. I mean, pro-life is another thing completely. Pro-water, excuse me. It's been a long day. And when we talk about the water, as Mark has referred to, it is the lifeblood of Mother Earth. As we talk about the water, we're talking about something that we all share. What has changed in my lifetime, I'm 66 years old at this point, but what's changed in my lifetime is this way of thinking about water. Molly was nice enough to bring us some water, and it's nice to have a drink of water. When you're up speaking for a long time, it's nice to have something to wet your throat, but it's necessary for life. And this commodification of these things, turning it into a commodity that you buy and sell, is not right. Our right to life is built within, you know, that's what we've always talked about. In the Constitution, we have inalienable right to life and to pursue happiness. But it's very difficult. When I've been in ceremony and gone without water, it's very difficult to be happy. So these things are much more important than we think. One of the things, as my brother Mark had brought it up, that when we talk about these things, it's not something new to us. It's an old thought. But at the same time, we have to continue to bring it forward as indigenous people because of this thought pattern that's kind of become, trying to be put upon us, if you will. It's brought to us in an ad form, you know. And if we started making a little bit of sound, all of you would start remembering these ads from these sounds. I believe we elected a new president based upon little jingles. Lock her up. You know, there's a lot of different little jingles that he used in order to get people. So we're brainwashed in ways that we don't understand it. And so free thinkers are necessary. We want you to be free thinkers. We don't want you to think our way. We don't want you to become who we are.
We're not selling anything here. We're just trying to make you aware of the fact that you are being hoodwinked by these corporations. These corporations and this corporate state does not care about you. Only your mother and father and your family care about you. We care about you because we want you to think. In the American way is thinking. It has to do with freedom. It has to do with inclusivity. It has to do with being good, upstanding people. And that's what really we're talking about here. We're not, one of the things in talking to the legislature when we would sit in front of them, one of the things they were trying to do from my perspective was they would ask us, well, at what point would you allow a mine there? And that bothered me because it was like they were trying to label us as anti-mine by asking that question. And that's not where we're coming from. You know, where we're coming from has more to do with standing up and speaking for it. The other point that I wanted to make had to do with digging up of graves. And that's one of the things near and dear to all of us. At what point would you allow them to go dig your grandmother up in order to prove her blood that maybe she was Irish, or maybe she was Indian, or maybe she was from Africa? At what point is that okay? Because they don't allow that to you. They don't do that to you, but they do that to us. In 1956, the most recent, that's when I was 5 years old, they dug those bones up and they put them on a shelf. These are my ancestors. And we buried them this past weekend. And that's not even considered an atrocity. The things that they've done to us as Indian people is not right. But we continue to advocate for this country. We continue to advocate for us as human beings, all of us. And that's what we want to get across to you more than anything. Let's hold on to our humans. These corporations do not care about us. They do not care about our children, and they do not care about our grandparents. We are the only ones that care, and we need to get rid of them somehow, some way. I believe it's possible because they came out of our thought pattern, and we can change that thought pattern, send them back where they came from, and become human again. Can you feel that? Is that real or not?
Yes.
And when will you stand for this country? And when will you stand for the people of this country? Because we need to stand together. That's the only way we're going to stop this corporation. These corporations. That's my thought. We have another presenters here, Lori and Jerry. Maynard, I'm going to come up and have a few words to share with you. Thank you very much.
Hi there. Thank you. One of the elders and the teachers that taught us a lot of things, one of the things that he always brought to me was that you can't share something until it's alive within you. So we're here, we're speaking about all these things, and they deeply affect us. They deeply affect the place of our creation story, but they deeply affect all of us. It's not because we just care about what this is going to do to the Menominee people. It's going to affect more than just the Menominee people. It's going to affect all life along that river, all life along the shores of Lake Michigan. They've been found. Also in this beautiful place with these rich minerals that were in the air today.
Under the apple tree.
And that they'd soon be digging into this ground. The place of your creation story. This is what they're going to do at the Mall of Kingdom Hill. The place of our creation story. How many of you gone fishing?
at the end of this day, you can go outside and you can check out the beautiful woods. Go check out that lake once more. Take a lot of pictures. Take a lot of pictures. Because in a few years, it may not look like that. And you may want to share that with your children to come, your nieces, your nephews. I'm hoping that each one of us think about that and think about the fact that we don't want to show the pictures to our children. We want to take them there. We want to climb a tree, put our feet in the water, look down and see fish that are swimming. So yeah, we're not asking you to fight a fight, but we're asking you to use your voices. We're asking you to be who you are, to remember that this land is all of ours. This Mother Earth that we're standing on is there to help us, but we're guardians, each of us. And each of us play our part, do our thing, but respect.
Thank you each of you for being here, for coming here.
So that's, that kind of ends the evening in a certain sense. We appreciate you taking this time to come here and be with us. We appreciate the fact that you don't get that time back, but you've given it to us. We thank you for coming and listening. We want to show our respect for you also. And although all of you out there in internet land, we thank you for taking the time to listen, those of you that have had the time. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.
Questions?
Oh, anybody got questions? Come on. Come on.
Although Leopold once said that the conquering role is eventually self-depleted, and what this means is that if we don't learn to live harmoniously with the land, if we just think that we can conquer it and do what we want for in the now profits, we won't be able to ensure our future of cultural sustainability, environmental sustainability, social sustainability, and even economic sustainability. So if anything you heard today sparked interest in you and wanted to take action, we have the phone numbers of key legislators and senators out on the table in the back, and you can contact us, come up to us if you have any more questions or want more information. In terms of Carroll University, this is just going to be the beginning of our Place in the Movement. We're going to have more events, so hopefully write letters and contact our legislators as well. And we'd like to thank all of you for coming, and have a great night. If you have any questions.
There's a lot of answers to that question, but I'm going to do the shortest one and the one that's important to me. My son's a part of the NoDAPL legal defense team in Mandan, North Dakota, so is his mother. And I'll say something that isn't often shared, and now it's going to be out there on YouTube, which is fine. You got our playbook, we got yours. Think about getting offline. When stuff starts hitting the fan, we need people that don't have electronic tracks on. So think about it. Think about your Facebook pages. Think about your Snapchats. Think about all the things that you're on where people can track you down, try and control you with your emotions. They can try and do all those other kinds of things. Think about lessening that electronic footprint and begin starting making teams to help if it comes down to direct action. I can't represent the movement, and I'm not. I'm just representing reality from my point of view.
One thing that everyone can do is to contact the investors in Aquila Resources. And we have an action alert here. And if you don't If there aren't enough copies afterwards, there's a website called nomad40.org, which is the Menominee Tribe's website, and we have the same information on that website of the three hedge funds that are investing in Indian Hill Resources. And the basic message to the investors is that this project has no social license to operate, and that they should withdraw their investment in Akilah, not because they may feel any sense of social or environmental responsibility, but because they are at risk of losing their investment because this mine will never take place.
Are there any other questions? Sure, come on, please. This is Keisha, who's helped organize this.
Well, I'd just like to say that there's a lot of people who have helped organize this, the River Alliance of Wisconsin, the Water Protectors of Milwaukee, the Sierra Club, the Gaia Coalition Network, and all of us have worked really hard to organize the speaking tour. But the point of this is not just education, because as much as it's important for all of you to know about this, it's much more important for all of you to act, for all of you to speak out, and for all of you to get your voices out into the community. So if you can, please send letters to your legislators. Call your legislators. Tell them that you do not stand for this. Write letters to your editor and to your local newspapers. Inform your community about what you think and what you think is important. Inform them what you learned at this presentation. Talk to people around you, talk to your friends, talk to your family, your community. Get these conversations going, because that's how awareness spreads about all these issues. So as much as you can, get your voice out there, because us learning about all of this is not going to make the difference. It's us doing something after we learn about all of this. So please, if you can, go out there and have those conversations. So thank you.